This is Wang.
Mrs. Wang, are you with us?
I am paying attention.
The larynx, or voice box, is a kind of gateway that either allows or stops the flow of your breath to and from the lungs. Most of the time, the gateway is wide open for breathing. But when we speak, the vocal cords come together and vibrate. Then we take a quick in-breath, then they vibrate again for speech, then another quick in-breath, and so on. With nasendoscopy, which I've had done to me, by the way, we can see the vocal cords themselves.
There are two vocal cords. When breathing in, the vocal cords open, which allows air to pass into the windpipe and to the lungs. When making sound, the vocal cords close and vibrate against each other.
The vocal cords are also called the vocal folds, and they vibrate by being pulled together just enough so that they vibrate in the airstream like curtains flapping in the wind. Now, that space between the vocal folds is called the glottis, and the third basic state for the folds to be in is to be held together, stopping the breath, and that's what we call a glottal stop. It's silent while it's being held, but if we suddenly release the pent-up breath, it makes a sound of its own. In some languages, the glottal stop is a fully fledged consonant, and then there are languages with ejective consonants, which involve glottal stops and which I made a video about. The glottal stop is always hovering around English accents, trying to get in on the action. Some English accents use glottal stops to reinforce P, T, Ch, and K, and this includes those ejective sounds which some English speakers use.
Everyone's kind of saw me as a joke. A joke.
A far more well-known guest appearance in English is when the glottal stop is a replacement for T, as in Great Britain. When this happens, some people mistakenly call it T dropping. Many of you have requested a video on T dropping or T glottaling, and I promise I'll make one soon. But first, we have to look at another way that glottal stops get used in English, and I think it's been getting more and more common. This other way involves not consonants, but vowels. When you say a word that starts with a vowel, the folds have to be brought together the right amount to get them vibrating. Now, the option exists to first bring them together firmly to make a glottal stop, and then to go from the glottal stop abruptly into the vowel. Starting a vowel from a glottal stop like this is called hard attack. Here are a couple of words from the Cambridge Online Dictionary.
Arm.
Actually.
This pronunciation of arm begins gradually. While this pronunciation of actually begins very clearly with hard attack. Why would we use hard attack? Well, according to my teacher John Wells, in his well-known Longman Pronunciation Dictionary, in English hard attack is not customary, but it is sometimes used for special effect as a way of emphasising the importance of a word. Now, this is very different from, say, German, where hard attack is called Glottisschlag or Knacklaut, cracking sound. In German, we can say that hard attack isn't emphatic, but just the normal everyday way of beginning a word initial vowel.
Heute Abend.
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 Erinnert ihr euch an Ute? Erinnert ihr euch an Ute?
I find hard attack most noticeable when it happens between words or even inside words.
Erinnert.
This is because without hard attack, an initial vowel in the middle of a phrase will simply be attached to the preceding word. Anyone who's ever edited a video with speech knows perfectly well that most of the time words just run together with no gaps between them. A lot of phoneticians prefer to live in a fantasy world of transcriptions that simply carry over the gaps between the words from normal orthography. But that issue needs a video all of its own. The frequent use of hard attack is one of the things that gives German its distinctive sound, though this constant chopping off of the voicing can sound to some people, well, choppy.
Erinnert ihr euch an Ute?
English, by contrast, is much smoother, at least according to that description by John Wells, which says that hard attack is only used in English to give special emphasis. And that was pretty accurate for male speakers of old RP. Here's one old male RP speaker reading a speech in German the other day. He remembered to use hard attack some of the time.
Wie ich Ihnen für Ihre überaus freundlichen Worte.
But when he got to the words meaning this evening, the word evening required no special emphasis, and he fell back on linking R.
Es ist wunderbar, heute Abend, heute Abend.
As he frequently does in English.
Cheetah and snow leopards.
A great place to listen to old RP is Pathé newsreels. And when I was watching this video from the 1940s, I noted that the then Archbishop of Canterbury used practically no hard attack at all.
The King has called us to observe today as a national day of prayer and dedication. We pray thee to bless our nation and its allies. Look in pity upon all who suffer. Justice, peace, and goodwill among the nations, a prayer we all know and which our Lord has taught us.
But in contemporary English pronunciation, we hear hard attack considerably more often.
Our Father, which art in heaven.
Our Father in heaven.
In earth.
On earth.
Deliver us from evil.
Deliver us from evil.
Forever and ever.
Forever and ever.
And notice that contemporary hard attack is often clearly not emphasising the word it's on.
Our Father in heaven.
The speaker there isn't trying to emphasise the fact that Our Father is in heaven, as opposed to under it or behind it. I devoted a whole chapter of my book English After RP to this non-emphatic use of hard attack in contemporary English, in contrast to the smoother linking of old RP. But nowadays, in some places and contexts, English hard attack can reach practically German levels.
Ultimately, the debate between, like, should I update my book or unpublish it, and this design is actually on all of my books as my publisher logo as well.
The outpouring of grief was instantaneous. Both his friends and supporters responded in disbelief and anger.
I am, yes, in the know of what is going on, but I am not sending all of those emails back and forth, and...
In fact, we can find hard attack being used not just on vowels, but on some consonants, like L.
And element number three here is lighting. Lighting.
It may be that young American women are in the vanguard, as they often are with speech innovations. But they certainly aren't the only ones who use large amounts of hard attack.
I'll be going over the overarching major issue with Amazon.
Watergate's biggest impact is that today, whenever a scandal happens,
the bright lights of the Big Apple just got a whole lot more festive.
The unlikely pilgrimage of Harold Fry and the love song of Miss Queenie Hennessy. You can really read these in either order.
One kind of hard attack is heard very widely from Americans, especially younger Americans, and increasingly from younger Brits, so of course it's in my book. This is when these words occur before vowels. Now, I have the more traditional pattern, where these are the and t before consonants, but the and to before vowels. So, the start to start, but the end to end. But increasingly, we hear speakers using just the and t, even before vowels. However, as I pointed out in my long video on vowel categories, English hates hiatus, that is, vowels coming into direct contact, and especially adjacent vowels blurring into each other. And so we generally get hard attack to keep the vowels apart. The end to end.
People like to add gate to the end of it.
Brits, like me, hate hiatus so much that you can occasionally get overkill, where a speaker starts to use linking R, or rather separating R as I'd rather call it, and then throws in hard attack for good measure.
And I now chair a large teaching hospital trust.
Non-emphatic hard attack does seem to be more characteristic of some speech styles than others. For example, giving information or explanations, especially to public audiences. And this is what I call presentational speech, like what I'm doing right now. And in this kind of style, heavy use of hard attack can be found way back.
Police are conducting inquiries under the Prevention of Corruption Act. This concession on ours is the first for any major industry.
There were traditions of elocution going back to the 19th century, which actually advocated heart attack. And I think we can probably hear echoes of that tradition across the years down to the present day. You might say that heart attack in presentational speech isn't being used to emphasise the particular word that it's on, but to emphasise everything, to try to be extra clear by indicating those word boundaries, or morpheme boundaries, though it's possible to get the boundaries wrong.
Humans innately compare themselves to the people around them.
The speaker there has put heart attack on the stressed vowel of innately, A. But of course, that isn't where the word is historically divided, because its main part is the same nate that's in native and prenatal.
Innately.
It's my impression that when speakers stop presenting and shift to more normal one-to-one conversation, the amount of heart attack tends to decrease.
Hey, I just tried to give you a call because I saw that you were at my front door at my other property. Yeah, so I'm not sure if I gave you the wrong address or if it's because I'm in your guys' system.
And this is why, to end with a bit of advice for English learners, I feel fairly justified in encouraging those non-natives who want to sound more native to practice linking initial vowels to a preceding word, especially when the words form a collocation or commonly occurring combination, like, for example, or state of the art.
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 I think it's probably also true for most speakers that heart attack is less common on weak vowels, as in of and uh. Compare these native and non-native speakers from the Speech Accent Archive, saying, maybe a snack.
And maybe a snack for her brother Bob.
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 Those non-natives were German, Japanese, and Chinese.
I am paying attention.
But of course, we have to remember that there are languages that really don't have much use for heart attack, like French and Italian.
And maybe a snack for her brother Bob.
And maybe a snack for her brother Bob.